This is the Ark of the Covenant, 3 that bear witness. In our last episode, I left you in the home of a gentleman in northern Minnesota. I had just heard the story from this gentleman that was sent to give me a message from the Almighty. He had driven 10 hours from Illinois up to meet with me. I had never met him before, I'd heard about him, and he first started out by telling me the story that I'd heard bits and pieces of, in which he was awakened in the middle of the night. He was told to fly to Vietnam, and then once he got there, after a couple weeks, he was instructed where to find 70 women and children and get them out of the country to America. He was able to do this through a miraculous series of events, got them back to America, and now, years later, he is sent up to give me the message, you need to go see Henry Groover. He then also told me that a friend of his was going to be going to Vietnam. And I said, I've got a gift for him. Reached into my pocket before I pulled it out. He said, wait, let me call him. It turned out that this gentleman had been up north at one of his customers' place that morning, was backing out of the long driveway when he was flagged down, and then he ran out to him, and he said to him, you need to go see Michael Rood as soon as possible. He said, who is Michael Rood and how do I find him? He said, don't worry, you'll find him. He goes back, drives back to his office, puts the key in the door while the phone is ringing. He picks up the phone, and that is when Victor is on the phone and says, I need you to come over here and meet someone. And I could hear on this end of the phone, is he a vet? And yes, he's a vet. And he said he was a Marine. And he said, I'll be right there. He comes into the door opens, in walks John Hanna. Victor introduces me, this is Michael Rood. And he then tells me the story of what had just transpired in the previous hour. He then tells me the story of how he was two men who were left of his entire battalion that was cut down in Vietnam. He was then nursed back to health in one of the tunnels until he was strong enough to get back to the Americans. And now he said, I know that I have to go back to Vietnam and I have got to speak to this family. I've got to bring the gospel of the kingdom to this family in Vietnam. And then I pulled out from my pocket a 100 dong Vietnamese note and I handed it to him. And he said, that was a sign that I was waiting for. I was given that 100 dong Vietnamese note 2 days earlier after I finished teaching. The Almighty is working all these things together at this point, and now I know that this man is on his way to Vietnam, and I know that this message is from the Almighty that I must go down and see Henry Groover. I don't know Henry Groover, but we make our plans to go down to see Henry Groover. It turns out that I'm the only one after much discussion about getting a whole busload of people and making the journey down there. I'm the only one that goes down. I am in a borrowed Toyota pickup truck. I drive down the 10 hours to get there. I get there just in time. I have a recording unit that is with me, and there's one seat left in the television studio where this is going to transpire over the next 2 days. One seat left, and it is right the front seat in front of Henry Groover. I couldn't ask for anything better. I asked him if he opposed me recording it because I had a high quality cassette recorder, and so I recorded that as Henry then laid out his life and his vision. Now, what transpired during that teaching that night and the next 2 days was something that was going to profoundly change my life. As I sat there in front of Henry, he told me that he had traveled to nearly every continent on the planet, and his job was to walk every street of these communities and to pray. And while he did that, while he prayed in this prayer walking that he did literally for decades, he would be given specific revelation about that community and what he was supposed to be praying about. After giving us a lot of background so that I knew that this is a man of God. This is a man who walked by the Spirit, and the proof was there in his life and in his ministry. Then he took us to Jerusalem when he prayer walked Jerusalem. He gave the detail of what during that time was the seam, which is a demilitarized zone between the two parts of Jerusalem, East Jerusalem, and the free part of Jerusalem. And then he told about going to a hotel where he was staying. At the end of his stay there, a man walked into the hotel, and he said that he never stays there, but he was speaking in the hotel. He heard another American speaking English there, and so the two of them met. And Henry Gruber said the man told him that he was in northern Turkey, in the mountains of Urartu, where they were doing some subsurface interface radar equipment, using it on what they believed to be the remains of Noah's Ark in northern Turkey. And he said, when I was there, he said, the Lord told me to get to Jerusalem, to go to this hotel, because there was a man there he needed to tell about the Ark of the Covenant. Rabbi Shlomo Gorin, the chief rabbi of Israel, before his death, revealed that the Ark of the Covenant was never lost. It was deliberately hidden. It was hidden in Mount Moriah, which the Temple Mount is part of Mount Moriah. The highest peak of Mount Moriah is north of the city gate of Jerusalem. The very highest peak of it today is now an Arab graveyard in East Jerusalem. Rabbi Shlomo Gorin said the Ark of the Covenant was not lost. It was deliberately hidden in Mount Moriah. He said, I have been in the chamber. I have seen the Ark. Now, we know the time frame that he was there. It was the same time frame where the Ark was reportedly having been found, but they knew they couldn't get the Ark of the Covenant from where it was out into the hands of Israel through the way it was found, through this archaeological dig. But they had to find the original route in, and for 7 years they attempted to get to the Ark of the Covenant, to remove it from where it is in East Jerusalem, under the ground of East Jerusalem, and to get it into the hands of Israel safely and securely. Henry was taken to this site by Ron Wyatt. He was given the background on this. And then Henry came to the United States and told us what happened. He was invited, very strangely, to speak to a group of Orthodox Jews in New York City. And they asked him to speak on the Ark of the Covenant and what he knew about the Ark of the Covenant. In this room full of Orthodox Jews, black hats, peyotes, black coats, Orthodox Jews. He then told the story of what he knew about the Ark of the Covenant and the detail on the Ark and what Henry saw when Ron Wyatt took him to that place, because Ron Wyatt said, the Lord told me to go to this place in Jerusalem at this hotel because there's someone that he needed to tell about the Ark of the Covenant, because there were many things that could not be said, but Ron Wyatt was told, and Henry Gruber was the man. Henry Gruber then related how he was speaking to this room full of Orthodox Jews, and then, as he was closing, a rabbi came forward and he said, I am sworn to secrecy. I cannot say anything about the Ark of the Covenant. But what this man just declared to you is true. And then he laid out a series of photographs on the table from the archaeological dig, not of the room where the Ark of the Covenant is, but other things, and he said that what Henry Gruber was saying was true. He had been in the chamber, and he too had seen the Ark of the Covenant. That is why Henry Gruber was invited to speak to this group of Orthodox Jews, because he couldn't say, but he knew that the people needed to know. Because that Ark of the Covenant and the testimony that is buried in the earth is exactly what John spoke about. John, in the Gospel of John, when it comes to the time of the crucifixion, he being the only male disciple that was there on the site, when he saw the earthquake and the rocks rend, in other words, an earthquake, the ground splits open, and then a Roman soldier comes up and plunges a spear into the side of Yeshua. He rips his side open and outpours blood and water from his side. And for the first time in 20 chapters, John stops the entire narration and said, I, John, saw it. I saw this. What did he see? I saw this. He is the one that declares that Yeshua is the Son of God, and I saw this, and I know that Yeshua is the Son of God, the Son of the Most High. He is the Messiah. What did John see? In 1 John, we read that there are three that bear record in the earth: the Spirit, the water, and the blood. And these three agree. If we have received the witness of men, and that's how you and I saw and believed in the Messiah, the witness that God gave of his Son is greater than the witness of men. And this is the witness God gave of his Son. And this, what is this? The three that bear witness, that bear record, the testimony that is buried in the earth: the Spirit, the water, and the blood. And what happened at the crucifixion and where the Ark of the Covenant was hidden. I sit back in my chair and I am floored. This is 6 months after I first saw Ron White's testimony, and I wouldn't show it to anyone else. I couldn't believe it. It was too big. The testimony was too big. I had to have another witness. I had to hear more about this. I couldn't just take it from this video. Oh, I'd show people the video of Noah's Ark. I'd show them about Sodom and Gomorrah. I'd show them about the Red Sea crossing, and I'd shut the thing off. I just couldn't go there. And now, Henry Gruber is laying this thing out of what he saw when the Spirit told Wyatt to go and tell him the testimony. Henry Gruber is telling the story now of what he heard when he was invited to speak to a group of Orthodox Jews, and the man who invited him, he came forward and said, I am sworn to secrecy. But what this man is telling you is true. I have been in the chamber. I have seen the Ark of the Covenant. Obviously, when Shlomo Gorn went into that chamber, there was more than one person that went in with him at that point. The following day, Henry Gruber shared about the other vision that he had concerning the rebirth of Judah and what is going to be transpiring at the end of a war, an existential war, in which Israel will be brought to the brink of destruction. If not for the hand of the Almighty, there would be no Israel. But out of that will come a revival, awakening, and the blindness in part that's happened to Israel is going to be removed. This is what Shaul prophesied. Paul prophesied of this very thing. Then blindness in part has happened to Israel, and it's actually been, in a way, a benefit to the Gentiles. But that blindness in part is going to be removed, and when it is removed, it's going to be like life from the dead. It's going to be a new day and a new age. Just as Chaim Goldman was sharing about the Upper Room conspiracy a little bit earlier, Christians told him that the Last Supper was the Passover. He got all excited about this. As he said, he's in production. He went out and produced tracts and started handing them out in the street, but yet he's a storyteller. He's an editor. He's a television and movie man. He read the rest of the script and said, wait, the Last Supper is not Passover. You read one verse so you could make it out, but you read the whole script and it's impossible. Any Jew can see that it's not The Last Supper is not Passover. He said, yeah, you gotta quit listening to Gentiles interpret scriptures Jews have written, Chaim. And so that's when Haim, when he heard me tell the story, he knew this is what he was ordained to do in his life. All of his training, everything he did in his whole life. His mother passed away that year. He took his entire inheritance and financed a Rood Awakening to get started. Completely dedicated to make this thing happen. And now he's here to see as this mushrooms, as Biblical LTV launches off on its own to touch the entire Christian and Messianic world. Ladies and gentlemen, the hand of the Almighty is revealing things in this day and time. And the rebirth of Judah, I took that recording and I put it out there by the thousands. I wanted people to hear that testimony and hear the testimony of Henry Gruver. Henry had already plans for this weekend for Shavuot, was not able to be with us. But we have two more major feasts this year. And hopefully we will have not only Henry Gruver here, but also we're going to see if we can get a gentleman that was actually down in there with the film crew in the excavation site with the film crew and caused a cave-in in that site. The man who then got that video back to the United States of America, put it in his top right-hand drawer, and then all hell broke loose, and the big television studio that he built down called Heritage USA, he was taken away from, and he was in prison, and the videotape ended up missing concerning him being down in the Ark of the Covenant dig with Ron Wyatt. We'll see. We'll see if we can get Jim Baker in to tell the part of the story that he knows. And also Mark White, Shomer Levon, who was sent from the Shomron with a revelation, a vision. Don't take any money. You and Yohanan, this 80-year-old man, walk to Jerusalem, the 18 hours, and to go to a cave at the foot of the highest peak of Mount Moriah to go there to pray. I'm going to be able to tell you a little bit about his story, but ladies and gentlemen, there's more than three witnesses. It's not even up to the witness of Ron Wyatt at this point, just as the Red Sea crossing. Dr. Moeller, Karolinska Institute, a scientist with a laboratory that awards the Nobel Prize in Science, taking underwater robotic dive cameras and the most modern research equipment and literally drives the cameras among the coral-encrusted remains of Pharaoh's army strewn for a mile and a half under 900 feet of water in the bottom of the Red Sea. Ladies and gentlemen, it's not even up to Ron Wyatt's testimony and little 8mm films and old VHS tapes that have been copied 1,000 times over. It's not up to that anymore. Mount Sinai, it's not up to Ron Wyatt's testimony. Jim and Penny Caldwell were sent there. American oil field engineer Jim Caldwell and his base was what? The Midian oil field. And was able to get tens of thousands of artifacts from the real Mount Sinai out to the Western world as far as well as high definition photographs. All these things, ladies and gentlemen, the rocks are crying out. And I believe they have to cry out because the people of the Almighty have shut their mouth. They are afraid to speak up. They've had evolution shoved down their throats. They are made out to be fools if they believe that the Creator created the heavens and the earth. I say the morons that teach Darwin's theory of evolution, which is so disproven by science, it is you've got to be a complete moron to even go there. I am tired of all this hockey foddy out there. Take Darwin, dig him up from the genius corner and bury him in the morons corner of Westminster Cathedral. He's dead wrong. And all those who keep on hyping his stuff, all the scientists that follow him, all they do is mouth their stuff, but they produce nothing. All the genius inventions on planet Earth were done by scientists who were believers. These dimwits haven't done a thing, nothing, except create the things to enslave mankind, to bring us all into the Novus Ordo Seclorum, the New World Order, to destroy America, which foundation is God-given rights and responsibilities. Now, if there's no God, there's no God-given rights. There's only government-given rights, and we have found out that what the government giveth, the government taketh away. They make laws that they refuse to follow themselves, and no one can hold them accountable because they're paid whores. Congress and the Senate and the entire executive staff and now the judicial staff, nothing but whores, absolute whores. Now, after these introductory comments, the next day, Henry and Judith were then invited. He was speaking at a church. He asked me if I would like to go along. I got there and was sitting with Judith as Henry was sharing, and he wanted to, was going to share about the time he went to heaven. And I thought, oh no, not another one of these. I've heard 100 stories about people going to heaven. Every one of them looks different. Everything's different. It's like, how many heavens are there? Is there a dog heaven, a kitty heaven, a cow heaven? I mean, how many heavens are there? I hear all these stories, and you know, but I can relate in one way, is that the Almighty communicates to us in the visions, the pictures, and in our understanding. And so you get these different pictures because these are visions, these are revelations to the individual. And then they're usually given an assignment, you know? Now, go back there and do something. But what I never hear the revelation, but they seem to be doing, is they come back and now they go on speaking tours to tell us what heaven looks like. Wait, that wasn't the assignment, you idiot! Call this person back up, and if they don't do it, keep them. Now other people go to hell. Hell looks different. Somebody saw this cassette on my credenza in Israel. They came in. It said 10 minutes in hell. They said, "What's this all about?" I said, "Someone asked me to sing a couple of my favorite numbers." It's really about a person giving their vision of what it was like in hell. But when Henry said what happened to him, when his van rolled over and he was dead, the ambulances were there, he was dead. No life signs at all. For several minutes he was dead, and the story he told will stay with me the rest of my life. I sat there and I wept like a baby. I was just, you know, at first I was embarrassed. I mean, you know, I'm sitting there in a church and I'm just weeping. And then I figured, you know, these people don't know me. They'll never see me again. Just sit there and cry. What difference does it make? So I sit there sobbing like a baby because it was so real. And what was communicated was so absolutely important in my life. At the end of this time with Henry, I go back up north and I know I have to go see Ron Wyatt. I have to do it. So, I've gotten Ron's number, and actually I called him before because I was trying to find a fresh video of his presentation. I called him, he didn't have any. I called the Prophecy Club, there was one left. No, there was none left, but a secretary had it in her machine, watched it the night before and said she would send it to me, and that's what I used for my public presentation at Superior Shores 3 days later. Now, I call up Ron and I said, Ron, I need to come down and speak with you. I'd like to spend a couple days with you and talk to you about the Ark of the Covenant. And I immediately could hear in his voice, well, do you have some specific questions? You know, I could hear that it was like, I've got plenty to do. I don't need somebody coming along and asking me questions for 2 days. I know what that's like, okay? And so I heard that in his voice. I said, Ron, I believe that if you'll pray, the Spirit will tell you whether I'm supposed to come down or not. And he said, fair enough, call me back in 2 days. Bam, hung up the phone, called him back in 2 days, and he said, when can you be here? And he said, right now, and I said, well, I can come immediately. He said, right now, I'm in the middle of building out this old gas station that is going to be the museum. I'm moving my museum down south to Cornersville, and I really don't have any good place for you to stay. I'm up north, I'm up in Nashville, 60 miles north, and I'm down there all the time, I'm working at the same time. And I said, well, can you use some help? And he said, yeah. I don't have very good quarters down there. I've got one guy staying in a bunk in the back of this old garage. And I said, well, is it more comfortable than, say, the wet jungle floor in Panama during rainy season? And he said, yeah, I think so. I said, okay, I'll be down. Let me get things together. I start packing my bags, and something causes me to weigh like 800 pounds. I can hardly get my things packed. I'm trying day after day, and I can hardly move. I am just overcome with a heaviness that I can't budge. And I have no answer. Why is this not happening? Why can't I move? I mean, it is a physical thing that I'm going through. Finally, I get a phone call. And this phone call is from John Hanna, who had just come back from Vietnam. He asked if I could meet with him. We meet at a restaurant there in northern Wisconsin. He tells me the story, the miracles that took place when he went back to Vietnam. How that he went and met with these people, and he was able to communicate with them. He doesn't know Vietnamese. These people understood him fluently. Fluently. And he went through the detail of what happened during that time he went back to Vietnam, and then comes back and tells me the story. And then he said, can I pray for you? I said, yes, please do. And he prays for me, and he says, I see you with a bunch of men with long beards. And I said, there are a lot of men with long beards in Israel. And he said, you know, we're gonna end up there soon. I leave the restaurant, and I go back, and in an hour, I'm packed up in what I couldn't do for 3 days straight. I get on the road, and I also pack up a big stereo system and a rifle that I'd searched for 20 years. It took me 5 years to restore this magnificent piece of work as a once-in-a-lifetime thing, and I knew in order to make this trip, I was going to have to sell my last possessions in life. Everything else was gone, and I would never, ever have anything like this again. And so that's what I did. And I am on my way on the road to see Ron Wyatt, because I have to know, did he really find the Ark of the Covenant, or is this a fairy tale that was invented by the sick, twisted mind of an insane man? We're going to take a break for just a few moments. And at this time, I'm going to invite all of you who are out there in cyberspace. On this day and time, if you want to see this message continue to go out around the world, if your life is being changed, if you know that this is the truth, then I'm asking you to get involved. Stand with us. Help us. Make this thing happen. I need your help. I can't do it by myself, and heaven cannot do it by the sole help of heaven. Yeshua told his disciples to pray this way, let your will be done on earth as it is done in heaven. That means that we are the ones that do his will on earth as it is done in heaven. We're the ones that have to trust him. We're the ones that have to get involved, because the Almighty does not make checks. He orchestrates heaven and earth and allows us to do what we've been called to do in this life. And now, this is your opportunity to stand with this ministry. Get on the phone, make your commitment today. Be a part of taking the gospel of the kingdom that Yeshua and his disciples taught to the entire world. We'll see you in just a minute. Got in the vehicle from northern Wisconsin, began driving through the night through the upper peninsula of Michigan. Finally got down to visit my parents down in Lansing. And I needed to sell this equipment so that I could make the run. I'm in a borrowed truck. This is my last possessions. And so I went to a pawn shop where you get the highest price for anything that you want to sell. Sold my stereo for $1,000. And then when you get over $1,500 for a rifle at a pawn shop, you know that this was a very, very valuable rifle. But these were the last treasures that I had in life, and this is gonna finance me for a long, long period of time, because I've been used to living on $50 for a month or two at a time at this point. But this is it. I'm tapped out. It's gone. Everything that I ever had in this life is now gone, and I'm on my way to find out if this man really found the Ark of the Covenant, if these stories are really true, because I knew if they were, then that changes everything. Because now, I make the trip down and I find myself in a homemade rack with two bunks in it in the back of a garage that is going to be turned into Wyatt Archaeological Research Center Museum. And so I am down there and I'm working on the museum day by day. Ron comes down once in a while, but the curator, who will end up to be the curator of the museum, we spend most of the time working on a Quonset hut that is going to, that's being developed into his house. It was built as kind of a Quonset hut house. And being familiar with Quonset huts in the Marine Corps, since that's where I spent a lot of time in Quonset huts, I felt right at home being there. But every day, whenever there was a break from our work, I would go out and I would clean the windows inside and out on the old garage, which is now going to be the museum. And at the end of the week, when Ron came over here, came over and he was, as a nurse anesthetist, he was busy working in the hospital all the time. As he came and he saw that, he said that was the one thing that had bothered him right from the beginning. He wanted those windows cleaned, and when he came up and saw the absolutely sparkling, I mean, it was a glowing gem with the rest of the place in complete disarray. Well, Ron, when he came down that day, we were introduced to a gentleman that he had just met. Ron saw a hitchhiker going down the road, an old man who was hitchhiking, and Ron picked him up. He found out that he was hitchhiking because his brother was dying of cancer. This man had no money. He was homeless, but his brother was dying of cancer down in Georgia, and the only way he had to get there was to hitchhike. So Ron picked him up and began telling him about the archaeological finds, and then brought him over to the museum where we were working there. But on the way, he stopped, and as a edge of vegetarian, Seventh-day Adventist, he brought these veggie burgers from Burger King. If there's anything you ever want to eat, it's probably not a veggie burger from Burger King. But he brought this for everyone, including this gentleman, and we all sat around the table, and there wasn't enough chairs for everyone. So Ron gave this man his chair, and then Ron tipped over a drywall bucket, and Ron sat down at the end on a drywall bucket and continued to witness to this elderly gentleman. After dinner, then he took him down to the bus station and bought his ticket for him, bought a return bus ticket, and gave him a sum of money in order for him to be able to make the trip down there and see his brother. See, that event right there showed me Ron Wyatt's real heart. He's driving down the road and he sees a hitchhiker, and he is going to use what he found to witness to this person and give them hope. He was going to feed him. He was going to take care of him like a brother and take care of his entire trip. That's what Ron Wyatt did. That was his life. This was not a show. This is just what happened. Him tipping over a drywall bucket and sitting on it while everyone else had chairs, that was how Ron Wyatt lived. He didn't ask anyone to do anything that he wouldn't do himself. He dug in holes that I wouldn't be able to fit in. that wiry, lean man now had cancer and was still hammering away every day to get the gospel of the kingdom out as he understood it. At the end of the week, Ron asked me to come home with him. I was gonna spend the night with him up there, and this was our time just to be alone together. But during the week, I had quite a revelation to lead up to that day. As I was in the back bunking with the other gentleman that was there working as a carpenter, he told me that he had been over on the Ark of the Covenant dig and other things with Ron several times. He was a strong, wiry guy himself, and he told me about the time that when they were down at the crossroads, when they got down to that area. He said he was digging with Ron, and Ron took notice of this blackened substance by this cross hole that was broken open with an earthquake crack. And they dug out and kept on digging down into this earthquake crack, when then finally he turned to the gentleman, the carpenter, and right now, I'll think of his name any moment now, it'll come to me. And he said he took his tape measure, Ron broke the tip of it off and ran it down that earthquake crack another 20 feet before it hit anything, after they got it cleared out. Well, they have no idea, they just know that that earthquake crack went down 20 feet and then it hit something. They couldn't snake around it, it just hit something down there. And so they bring it back out, and then Ron said, "You have anything to put some of this in?" As he was scraping some of this black and hard substance off the rock right there at the cross hole. And so he said that he pulled out a 35 millimeter film container out of his pocket, unused film. He took the film, put it back in his pocket, gave Ron the 35 millimeter film container, and he took his knife and scraped off some of this into it. And then he closed it up and put it in his pocket. Well, in a couple days, the curator of the museum, who becomes a curator of the museum, when I meet him, I already know him. I read his book, Too Long in the Sun. Very impressed with it. A good researcher, did great work, good research. And in fact, a few weeks before up in Minnesota, I walked in to teach a group of people about Christmas and Easter and all these pagan things because of the time of year it was, and someone had this book, Too Long in the Sun. I opened up the book, and all I had to do was start holding up the pictures because he had documented this, and I was holding up the pictures. It was brilliant. It was wonderful. And so I went down there, and I saw, you know, this Richard Reeves on this book. I mean, no, it's pronounced Richard Reeves. So Richard invites me over to the house with his wife and his two sons, and I meet Murray and David. Well, Murray was born with spina bifida, open spine. Most children don't live very many years with this birth defect. But Murray was in his later single digit years, and he was still alive, but because of the diligent work of his father and his mother. See, in order for him to survive, these children are very susceptible to bacteria and diseases, and they have to be watched very carefully. Usually they only live a few years. But Richard was very diligent, and he got a microscope, and he was looking at his son's blood just about on a daily basis to see what was going on in his blood with what they fed him, and they were very diligent to watch over his son. And so he takes me back into a room where he said that there was a Dr. Nason's who came up with a microscope that allowed you to dial in certain light frequencies in order to use this, and it was a dark field microscope. He said that that is what he then was given by a scientist in a laboratory up in Canada, and he brought it down. It's like a $30,000 microscope that takes 2 8-foot tables to put the microscope and all of this apparatus on. I'm looking at something that very few laboratories have, and it's in this man's house. And this stuff was basically given to him. And so you know this is the hand of the Almighty, and here's his son who is still doing well. And then he shows me how this thing works. And then he tells me the story about how Ron Wyatt came back from Israel, and he handed him a film container, and he said, "Would you please look at this and tell me what you see?" And so Richard said that he put those dried, crusty things in a water solution, a sterile water solution, to rehydrate them, and put it under this 30,000 power Nason's microscope. The only more powerful microscope is the electron microscope. Electron microscope cannot look at anything living. It has to be dead, inanimate. But the Nason's microscope at 30,000 power, he dialed it in, and then he saw what you cannot see with any microscope on the planet except for a Nason's microscope. See, Dr. Nason's found out that in the month of July, for just a few days, the rays of the sun are of such a frequency that can illuminate things, and you can zero in to such a power that you cannot do at any other time of the year. And so Dr. Nason's created this light frequency microscope where you can dial in particular light wave frequencies to be able to see something you would never be able to see except for these few days during the summer in which the natural light of the sun has those light rays in it, unfiltered, and you can see it. He dials it down, 30,000 power. He looks at it, and right there, he sees somatids, a life force that is in blood that is swimming in this. Now, somatids never die. You can dry them out, they'll stop moving. But you cannot cut them with a diamond knife. You cannot burn them up. There is a life force in blood called a somatid, or a life force. It's also called, maybe someone can help in the audience besides somatid. This is what Nason's called them. It'll come to me. It's in there in the brain someplace. I'll let the subconscious work on it. Okay. We'll continue on the story until my brain gets back in gear. So the somatids, he's seeing this on this screen. This life force that is in blood that never dies. And he turns to Ron and he says, "This is blood." He said Ron turned white and sat down and then told him, or before he found it, at that cross hole with that earthquake crack. The earthquake, the rocks rent. They plunged the spear into his side, and out came blood and water. And I, John, saw it, and I testify, this is the Messiah. This is the Son of God. There are three that bear record in the earth, the spirit, the water, the blood. These three agree. If we've received the testimony of men, the testimony that God gave of his son is greater than the testimony of men, and this is the testimony that God gave of his son. That's why that rabbi in New York said, "I am sworn to secrecy." But what this man, Henry Gruber, is telling you about the Ark of the Covenant and where it is and what happened, I swear it is true. Shlomo Goren, the chief rabbi of Israel, before his death, the Ark of the Covenant was deliberately hidden in Mount Moriah. I've been in the chamber. I have seen the Ark. Now, there is a world of disinformation that deliberately goes out about this situation. I'm going to jump ahead just a little bit in time to tell you about that misinformation. But no, I'm not. I can't do that. Now I am seeing these people who were there, you know, the unbroken chain from taking that substance, putting it in a film case by the man that gave it to him, Ron handing that to Reeves, him looking at it under a microscope that no normal human being has on the planet, in their home. And then I looked at the video recorder. I look at the screen and I say, "You recorded that, didn't you?" And he said, "I wouldn't do that, would I?" And I said, "You wouldn't be able to resist." And he said, "You're right, I recorded it. Ron has allowed me to show it to one person." I went back up into Canada to where I got the microscope. They had some more things for me. I went back up there. I took the videotape, I put it on, and he said, "I want you to tell me what this is." And so this is the one that helped him develop and, to assemble this whole Nason's microscope. He looked at it and he said, "It's blood, classic somatids." Said, "They never die." And he said he was allowed to tell him one thing. It came from a 2,000-year-old crucifixion site in Israel. That's what he's allowed to tell him. And so he told him, what is it? It's just classic blood, classic somatids. And he said, "Well, it came from a 2,000-year-old crucifixion site in Israel." He said, 2,000 years, 4,000 years, 6,000 years, it doesn't make any difference. Somatids never die. It's a life force in blood that never dies. Sound a little familiar from Leviticus. The life of the flesh is in the blood. In fact, now what we know about somatids is that this is what the Almighty put in blood to where if your body is healthy, if you're feeding it the right things, if it is not overladen with toxins, that those somatids turn in a certain way that produces life. But if your body gets overladen with toxins, and if you're not putting in your body what it needs to regenerate itself, those somatids will turn the other way and put you in the grave. This is exactly what it tells us to, and Shaul speaks of, is to not defile your body, which is the temple of the Holy Spirit. He who defiles that temple, God will destroy. Because he put a life force in the blood that you are not going to continue to linger in a state that would have you in torment forever. If your body switches over and you are so laden with toxins and you no longer feed your body what it needs to heal itself, your body is designed to destroy itself and take you back to the dust of the earth. That's why what we're doing with Biblical Health TV is so important. That you get detoxified and you start feeding your body what it needs, because God Almighty has ordained that your body will destroy itself. But he also produces miracles and can heal us. And that's why when someone does something wrong, the woman with the issue of blood, the people that sin, go and sin no more. This disease of the Gentiles and the Egyptians has come upon you because you violated the Torah. Turn your life around and don't sin anymore. That's why the scriptures tell us to come out of Babylon. I'm hearing this whole story, and now it's my last night. Ron invites me to come up and stay with him, Mary Nell, up in Nashville. I have dinner that night, and then we sit down afterwards. He shows me the big piece of petrified of Noah's Ark, some of the other artifacts. But he doesn't show me any brimstone. Now, this is significant to me because, you know, to him it's nothing. I mean, there are millions of pieces of brimstone. Every tour I take over to Israel, we go out there and gather brimstone. It's nothing. But here it is. He doesn't show me any brimstone. We're sitting around talking, but I have prayed before the trip. I said, if the Ark of the Covenant, if this is true, I want a piece of brimstone. Something simple to ask, but Ron isn't even showing me the brimstone. That is nothing. He brings out the rock that was there as the placeholder for the a cross hole. He brings this out, we're talking about this. And then, here is the question I ask. Ron, the ninth chapter of Daniel. He who confirms the covenant is the Messiah. That's all I said. He said, that is right. It is the Messiah who confirms the covenant that was made in his blood when his blood anointed the most holy. And then he said, just a minute. He walks in the back room, brings out a baggie full of brimstone. And I said, Ron, that is the one thing I prayed for on this trip, that if it was true about the Ark of the Covenant, that you would give me some brimstone. And he said, I knew that. See, Hal Lindsey came up with he who confirms the covenant being the Antichrist making a land deal with Israel. Something that you don't see in the context of neither Daniel chapter 9 nor the entire book of Daniel itself. It was something that he extrapolated. It was something that he read into it. But because of an entire generation being awakened by Hal Lindsey's excellent book, and with such a powerful name, The Late Great Planet Earth, if that doesn't grab your imagination and cause you to get into this and read this, an entire generation was awakened by that book. Now, Hal knows that I completely disagree with him on the pre-tribulation rapture, but Hal is going by a presumption. The Almighty didn't tell him this. He continues to repeat what he was taught in his ultra-dispensational replacement theology upbringing, and he never thought the thing through. But he is a supporter of Israel. He was actually thrown off the air on TBN because he took a stand for Israel against the Muslim infidels. And then they brought him back on very quickly. They found out how popular Hal was. He has edited and changed his book in 47 major areas since those days. But the he who confirms the covenant, he hasn't touched it because he doesn't even know to go there. So people ask me, so how do you get the he as being the Messiah? Well, how is it that you get the he being the Antichrist? It's because you learned everything you know from someone who learned everything they know from someone who knew learned everything they know from Hal Lindsey's book in the late 60s. And it just got embedded into the entire Christian culture. After that, it was late. It's midnight, and it's time to go to bed. Said, Ron, I'm not gonna be able to sleep for 2 days. I'm leaving. You don't need to mess up the bed, I'm leaving. I drove from Nashville all the way to San Antonio, Texas, without even a cup of coffee. I mean, I don't think I slept for 2 days, because I knew that this leading of the Spirit that had been going on for so long finally results to where I can with confidence say that I know that this is the hand of the Almighty that led me down a path I would never dream of, that he brought people and he spoke to people to come and give me messages that could not be known in any way, shape, or form. He sent people that had no idea where I was or how to find me to connect me with these very things. And now I'm on my way to San Antonio, Texas. And when I get there, I'm taken by a group of people over to a meeting at the house of a messianic leader there. I sat around the table as they were planning this event that was coming up. I was just a guest, I kept my mouth shut. And it was a conference, a messianic conference that was coming up. A person that was a doctor in Aramaic was coming in. And he sat at the table and he said to his wife, he looked over and said, remember, 3 years ago, I told you that there was a prophet that was going to come to us, and he said, that's the man right there, and he pointed at me. He took me over to his office, he opened the door, he handed me the key and said, I'm going on vacation. This is your office. He took a prayer shawl that was on the back of his chair that was given to him by a rabbi years earlier, and he said, this is not yours. You're to hold it until you give it to the person that it belongs to. He took it off the back of his chair, put it on me, he walked out, and for the next 3 months, I taught the Feast of the Lord at that congregation. And that is what's going to take me to Israel and the rest of the details concerning the Ark of the Covenant. I'd like to pray. Yahovah, bless you and keep you. Yahovah, make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. Yahovah, lift up his countenance upon you and give you shalom in the name of Yeshua, the Messiah, the King of Kings, Yehovah Tzavaot. Amen and amen. Well, Shabbat Shalom, Torah fans. Shavua Tov. Have a good week, and we'll see you next week here for Shabbat Night Live. Ladies and gentlemen, it takes an extreme amount of energy, time, and money to make these broadcasts available, these teachings available to you and to those around the world. And we really need you to seriously stand with us on this very project that Yeshua put us on, to take the gospel of the kingdom that he taught to the entire world in the last days. The opportunity is there. With more than 30 people on staff just here in the United States to make these things available, it takes a lot of money. And if you appreciate the work that we're doing in reaching out to you around the world, please stand with us and stand with us today. Thank you.